Hello everyone, welcome to another episode of Front Row. With me today I have Mr. Kanishka Lad, a security specialist from International SOS. Mr. Lad, your company, can you briefly describe what your company does?
Thank you for the question, Professor. My company, International SOS, is basically involved in providing medical and travel security consulting for multinational corporations with operations across the world, including Sri Lanka and the larger South Asia region.
So you had some concrete experience here after the April 21st incidents.
Absolutely.
You guys did evacuations out of here. Absolutely. And things like that?
Absolutely, Professor. So after the attacks on the 21st of April during Easter, which was quite an unprecedented event, even for the corporate world, as it was for the government, we did many things which were focused at helping clients who were stuck in Sri Lanka, who were directly affected, who were facing medical emergencies. And what we did was, the first thing that we did was we sent out an incident management team on ground. As soon as the news that the attacks had hit multiple cities and luxury hotels, which were used by our clients as well. So we sent out an incident management team, including a security specialist, as well as a medical professional, a doctor, so that both the security as well as medical needs could be catered to immediately. As soon as they landed in Colombo, they panned out and they met clients directly face to face. They addressed the security concerns as well as treated them medically. And a few evacuations were also conducted because of the fact that there were certain clients who had critical injuries as well, and they were medically evacuated to their home country or to a safe haven, whichever was close by. So that is one thing that we did. Secondly, what we did was we provided actionable intelligence to our clients, especially in the post-incident scenario, because we couldn't gauge it before. So in a post-incident scenario, we gave out actionable intelligence, which was vetted intelligence, and it was just not information, it had assessment. It had an assessment to it, which increased its value, because in the social media or in the traditional media, usually what we get is only information. There is usually a lack of assessment. There's usually a lack of forecast what will happen. Also, I would like to mention that after the first incident management team was on ground, when they came back, over a span of two months, we sent two more incident management teams just to gauge how the situation was normalizing, how the situation had de-escalated, what were the security precautions in place, what was the security situation like, what were the measures that were taken by the government to apprise our clients that now it was quite safe to go back to Sri Lanka, go back and invest in Sri Lanka, to go back to your offices.
So one of the things that we are interested in is increasing our exports, right? Our goods exports, we have a target of increasing them. Service exports, we have a particular interest. And particularly with service exports, we need to have people coming and going.
Absolutely.
We need to have people coming to our establishments, factories, etc. So you see, this kind of thing really affects the economy on a larger scale. What can we do better to communicate to people like you who are giving advice to the people who have to come here? Because if you think that we are not doing a good job, your clients are not coming. How can we improve the information flow?
Absolutely. It's a very, very valid question. And mobility forms the basis of any international organization, because there will be a continuous flow of employees as well as VIPs, as well as senior management people coming into countries like Sri Lanka, India, and other developing countries from countries which are developed. So if it's a CEO who's coming for a very important meeting to a country like India or Sri Lanka, which is developing, he's going to face a completely alien environment. And that alien environment will present a number of risks to him, and that might affect him and his organization directly as well as indirectly. So what, in my opinion, we could do better is with regards to getting people into countries like ours, it is essential that we basically inform them that they are safe when they go to that country. How do we do that? We do that through duty of care, we do that through providing them with intelligence updates. We do that with providing them with emergency response plans, so that whenever they come into a country which is alien to them, they feel that they're secure, they feel that they're safe, that their organization and its employees are safe.
But that's your output. What are your inputs? What is it that you take in? I mean, if you're taking in bad information, whatever value addition that you do, it's still not going to be the real situation. How do you assess the quality of your inputs?
The quality of our inputs is basically a very, very well thought out system and structure that is in place in our organization, which has been in the business for the last last 35 years. So our inputs are basically very well vetted, may it be information, may it be any information about any government or any facility that might be in Sri Lanka or any other developing country or any other developed country. So all these things go through a very, very tangible and very, very robust process. Obviously, sometimes we do make mistakes. Sometimes there are certain things that we could avoid. But in the end, there is a very, very structured process when it comes to taking in information as well as responding to any emergency.
You know, when I'm at one of our tourist hotels, we have wonderful beaches here, as you know, I always see this red flag. And I say, these fellows are being overcautious, right? If you put the red flag and somebody drowns, you can say, we put the red flag. But even when the sea is calm, you put the red flag. Is there such a danger with organizations such as yours? Isn't there an incentive to be overcautious?
Well, there is obviously an incentive to be overcautious, but sometimes organizations are not ready to be overcautious. So they wouldn't go for services like ours because firstly, they don't see the need for them. But when they get actually affected by a calamity or an incident like the 21st April attacks, that is when they actually start feeling or start valuing what we have told them. Because of the fact that, as mentioned by me earlier, Asian economies are quite risk resilient, to be honest, and people are not aware. Even big organizations within countries like India and Sri Lanka are not aware of services that, for example, my company provides. They are getting there, they are learning more about it. But I believe that being cautious, maybe not overcautious, but being cautious is absolutely necessary to avert a crisis and to avert financial losses for corporations.
You see, I've been in this disaster space for a long time. And what I saw in our country, particularly after the tsunami, was that we were in a complete response mode, react mode. Absolutely. Relief was our thing. And after that, Kyoto framework and so on, Hyogo framework and so on, I think the thinking shifted to risk reduction, mitigation kind of things, rather than simply response. Is that happening? I mean, when you describe your organization, it sounded like a response or react organization. Right. Is there anything beyond that?
It's absolutely the opposite, actually, Professor, because even though we started as a response organization, because of our name, which is quite the misnomer, it's International SOS. So SOS means responding. But to be honest, response is the most minimal part of our business. So now we have moved on completely towards building resilience, towards building preemptive measures for corporations, rather than responding to any emergency and then being in a chaotic situation. Rather than that, we advise our clients, our corporations that have a worldwide footprint, to preemptively plan for incidents like the tsunami. And we can obviously, in today's day and age of technology, I think the IMD or the Meteorological Department, as well as a number of other security agencies, do keep on giving out alerts, do keep on giving out messages which just need to be collated, just need to be caught, and need to be conveyed to the relevant authorities, relevant management.
So overall, is Sri Lanka a risky country?
I believe in the South Asia context, it's one of the less risky countries, to be honest, because at International SOS, which is my organization, we have a very, very holistic and comprehensive risk rating process. And Sri Lanka has remained medium since ever. And this is a medium risk also because of issues like crime, because of social unrest, which is seen extensively across countries like India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, most of South Asia. I would say that Sri Lanka is, I think with regards to risk, it's quite down there still. And I think that the 21st April attacks should not be taken in the context of it being a hub of terrorism, because it was just the first such incident to occur. And most likely with the stringent measures that have been taken by the government, I see it as a one-off incident.
Right. Thank you very much. That's a good note to end on.
Thank you so much.